the American Revolution, young men looked at old wealth and wondered why men born free should be enslaved by poverty. The aristocracy was richer than ever, but for most, life was hard, often violent, and always shadowed by death. There was, though, a new world struggling to be born, and the forces unleashed in Europe would help mold the destiny of the land we call America. Who were the first Americans? Where did they come from, and why? And what happened to them when they reached our shores for the first time? This is the story of one of those men and of the family he founded, a story of that great American experiment in the brotherhood of man. And like the stories in each American's background, it begins in a foreign land.
You rang, Your Excellency?
A good day, August. I have come for the weekly cheese. Is your father here?
He's in the house. Dead. Drunk, that is.
I will come back later.
No. You haven't met my cousin, Bertrand. This is Philippe Charbonneau, the noted innkeeper from down the road.
Ah, the little lord you were telling me about. Lord of the cow cheeps.
I will have the cheese now.
I will have the cheese now. What makes you think you're so much better than we, huh?
I do not.
You lie. Because you can read? Because your mother was on the Paris stage?
Oh, an actress, was she, huh? You needn't wonder who your father was, my lord. You probably have 1,000.
Damn you.
We have those coins now, Your Highness.
The little skinny bargain.
Philippe! Gerard?
Madame?
I have told you about these books. I will not have sedition bred under this roof.
To you.
Nothing, Charlotte. I just had an accident. I fell down, that's all.
Someone beat you. Brigands? Since when have they picked on poor people like us?
Charlotte, I'm all right. I just need some sleep.
Poor Philippe, here. You need a little wine.
Where did you get the wine, Charlotte?
It's my bottle. I keep it put away.
And who gets the rest of what you steal, huh? Your family.
I drink it all. Oh, and had the loveliest dreams of a certain young man. What a pity they are only dreams and nothing more. Is it your first time? Is it?
If you have so graciously consented that I be given the privilege of working 10 hours a day in return for educating your son, you must at least permit me to do my duty as I see it.
Education does not lie in books which have been suppressed by the government. Banned.
Because they speak the truth. Throughout history, only lies have been freely promoted. Lies, never the truth. Jean-Jacques Rousseau. They may suppress him all they want, but what he and his fellows write will rattle the world to its foundations.
Time and time again, I have given you explicit instructions. No Latin. Additions and subtractions and English. No French. English.
Two treatises of government by John Locke, an Englishman.
Not this radical rot. Classical works. You are here to prepare Philip's mind for England.
Agreed. And I presume that you have instructed our dear buxom Charlotte to handle the rest.
Where is she?
Racine headed for the stable.
It is your mother?
Come down at once. Oh, my God. Did she rake you like that?
Madame.
You will leave.
Why? Because I had him?
Mama, no.
That's it, isn't it? I'm not good enough for your precious little lord. I'm not good enough. When he is a bastard, and you can't even get past the church door because...
Mama, no. She was only trying to comfort me, Mama.
Who beat you?
Well, you heard her, Mama. They call me a little lord. I hear it everywhere I go, and always with a sneer and hate. And I want to know why. And I want to know why not Charlotte. Huh? She was just being kind to me, Mama. I was hurting, and she brought me wine.
To trap you.
What do you mean, to trap me? What if I wish to marry Charlotte? Huh? The boys in the village are fathers at 17, Mama.
Marry Charlotte?
And why not? Why do you always treat me as though I am different from everyone else?
Because you are.
How, Mama?
Come inside. This is from your father. He wrote it in December of 1754.
Was that the year he died, Mama?
He is not dead.
What do you mean, he is not dead?
It was easier to let you think that. His name is Amberley. James Amberley.
Amberley. He is English?
Read it.
My beloved Marie, this is the letter I promised you in Paris. By the witnessing below, I declare in sight of Almighty God that my natural son, Philippe, is hereby acknowledged by me, and upon my death shall receive, in accordance with the laws of this realm, an equal share of my estate, save for Kentland itself. What is Kentland, Mama?
The family residence. Go on.
Kentland, which by custom must pass to my legitimate son's eldest male issue. He has another son?
One. Your half-brother.
This is my true and irrevocable intent. The whole declaration being freely made by my own choice. Ever yours, James Amberley, Duke of Kentland. Mama, a duke? He is titled?
Yes, Philippe. You are a nobleman by birth, the son of an English lord.
Circle him! Circle him!
No! Get back! Stay away! Stop it! Get back! Get away from me!
Watch out!
You would have done better to stay out of this.
Cousin! Cousin! Murderer! You killed them!
And you will find yourself in a similar condition if you are ever seen near Chavagnac again! I am giving you a chance. Take it! Lucky he knew nothing of firearms. I could have never gotten a ball off in this stamp. The powder would have flashed in the pan.
Is he dead?
Yes. Yes, I would say so. A spontoon is not just for show. They are killing instruments.
Dear God.
The crime was theirs, not yours. Any soldier has the right to kill his enemy in battle.
In battle? But this was not their war.
Oh, but it was for me, my friend. They were taking me for ransom. I will take care of the body if you will fetch my horse,
Philippe. My name is Philippe Charbonneau.
I am Gilles.
Just Gilles?
Well, for you. For the rest of the world, it is it's a bit more tedious. I am Marie-Joseph Polive Roche-Gilbert du Mortier. The Marquis de Lafayette.
I do not believe it for a minute. You stole the cheeses.
I did not. His aunts gave it to me. Look at the Saint-Nectaire, the most expensive kind. Here, go ahead, count. You will find every sou I took with me.
Here we thought you met up with the brigands again, but in this case it was only a marquis.
Saint-Nectaire it is. I had some only once before in my life.
Philippe. How did you get on with the Marquis? Easily?
Yes. And he says we are blood comrades.
You see, Gerard.
Have I not said it many times before that any man of breeding would recognize it in my son?
Blood comrades? Most peculiar term for a friendship between boys, is it not?
Well, it is. Just because I helped him save his horse after it unseated him and ran off, like I told you.
Scarcely an act of courage under fire.
Well, it is just his way of speaking. Everything in military terms.
We should have some wine. Some good wine.
Yes. Gerard.
Yes, my lord.
Do not mind him, Philippe. Tell me more about the Marquis, the chateau. Is it grand inside?
Yes, Mama, it is.
And he actually said you were blood comrades.
Yes.
Well, do not just stand there. Reload. Oh, faithful Brown Bess. The finest military weapon in the world. You know King George's redcoats can load and fire in 15 seconds. Yes, that is why we French hate Georgie and his muskets. Ah, if we had them, we could rule the world. But lacking them, we have nearly lost it.
Well, how did you obtain this one, Gilles?
From my military tutor.
And they call it Brown Bess because of the barrel?
No, Buon is the stock. It is a preservative they treat it with. You will not see another weapon like it. And when you see this one en masse, you had better prepare to die.
I come from Calais, for Madame Charbonneau.
Gerard. Philip's father has fallen ill. He wishes to see his son before he...
That is for our trip to England. We must leave immediately. Where is Philippe?
At the chateau.
Please go find him.
Garde. Change. Double change on the retreat. Double change on the retreat. Disengage. Lunge. Aha. Now I give you a real lesson. Set. Ferry prime. Good. Set. Ferry second on the retreat. Good. Good. Retreat. Good. 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 Set. Ferry cart on the retreat. Good, 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 good. Retreat, retreat, good. Set. Contre the cart. Good. Contre the cart. Good. Again. Good. Ferry prime. On my attack, you disarm me.
No, Gilles, I cannot.
Do it. Very good, Philly.
Bravo.
My lord, this man insists.
Madame Marie wishes for you to return immediately.
What, is something wrong?
You are to go on a long journey.
Well, that is fitting. For I too must journey back to the Academy in Paris. And I would like you to have something, Philly. Small token of our friendship. There. Now you have a briquet. Like any good French grenadier.
Achille, I do not deserve such a splendid gift.
What you have given me, neither of us may measure here. Beyond there is companionship and the pleasure of teaching inept people. Please let them suffice.
I hope to have the honor of meeting you again in Paris one day.
Well, if not Paris, then somewhere. A battlefield, maybe. Who can say? But I have the feeling with comrades in arms, it can be no other way.
Not approve. Not the gift or the journey.
The change.
Change? What change?
Philippe, I've been your tutor for 5 years. I found you bright, perceptive, honest with me and with yourself. Will you now tell me there has been no change in you?
Well, the whole world is changing, is it not? That is what you've been telling me.
We've talked about change for the good. This seems to be another kind.
Well, and you? Have you noticed something in yourself lately? Maybe a little envy?
Well, still perceptive, eh, Philippe? If not honest.
I will not be called dishonest. Not by a man who knew all along why he was here and never told me.
Your mother swore me to secrecy.
But you were false with me.
I was true on things that mattered.
But does not my life matter?
And what about the life of the goatherd's son, Auguste Duplay? Yes, they found his body. Killed by his cousin, they say. He's run off. Not that anyone really cares about either of them. Two useless fools who would never amount to anything. Is that what your friend the Marquis would say? Your blood comrade?
Does my mother think that? Have you accused me to her?
I do not accuse you of anything, Philippe. Except change.
I did not mean to kill him, Gérard.
Seems you had a reason. But concealing it, that was an act without conscience.
Yes, but Gilles said it was the enemy.
Gilles' words, Gilles' background, not yours, Philippe. You must remain true to yourself.
Myself? I do not even know who I am right now.
You are a young man. And for all of your mother's obsessions, not so very different from any other young man.
Yes, but I killed someone.
And you live with that. And other guilts, and pains, and pleasures, just like the rest of us. Soon you will learn that our mad master, Jean-Jacques, was right. He said we are all created equal. We are all born in a natural state of freedom. Power is not something which descends in selective rays of light from heaven to touch only a few of the especially appointed, like a king, or a marquis, or...
Or a duke.
Precisely. Philippe, there is nothing wrong with wishing to better yourself. But it is very wrong to consider yourself as better.
I will not, Gérard. Not again.
Good. You will go to England.
It is what my mother wishes.
A good enough reason, I suppose. Before you said that I seemed different too. Envious.
Yes.
You're right. A part of me does envy any man of wealth. I do not think that in these times I would wish to learn that I belong to a titled family.
And why not?
Because there are strong winds blowing, Philippe. Intellectuals would declare that contracts between governed and governors can be broken by the will of the people. Politicians like Monsieur Pitt in England, who stand before their own parliament and challenge the right of the English king to tax the American colonials. These strong winds may rise to a gale, to a revolution.
Where, Gérard? In England?
And in France.
Well, if that were to happen, would you support it?
I would support any activity against a nobility which considers another human life worthless when their own lives are at stake. I would oppose any man who disposes of an enemy simply because he feels he is shielded from reprisals by his own position.
All right. I have been a party to that crime. But there is one crime I've sworn I would never be guilty of.
What is that?
To die like the man I killed. In poverty. Yes, I'm going to England, Gérard. And I thank you for your friendship. But I'm finished with your books.
The point is, Philippe, they have not finished with you. Not with any of us. Here is my gift to you. Not as handsome as that of the Marquis, but every bit as powerful.
Friend. Mama? Mama, you are feverish.
I am all right.
Damn that English Channel. It is no wonder our armies have never crossed it.
Look, Philippe, look. This is what we came for.
Mama? Mama, this journey has been very hard on you. We should not have come at all.
This is your birthright. Come, we will see your father.
I am Marie Charbonneau. I have brought my son, Philippe.
I was not certain you would be able to converse in our language.
But since you can, we may conclude our business with greater dispatch.
A slight correction, please, my lady. I am not here primarily for business, as you term it. I am here because your husband wishes to see his son.
I fear that is quite impossible.
Dr. Bleeker is one of London's most respected physicians. He's staying at Kentland to attend my husband.
Well, the fate of his son might be the best medicine he could have.
True. But as to this particular young man, we have no evidence.
I have a letter granting Philippe his rightful share of James Amberley's estate. You know the letter, and to pretend otherwise...
I will have no loud voices in this house, madam. And I am the Duke's voice now. While I live, I will deny the contents of your letter with all my power.
And so will I.
May I present my son, Roger, and his fiancée, Alicia, daughter of the Earl of Parkhurst.
This is the Charbonneau woman?
Quite.
And this? I supposed half-brother, what?
I do think there's a resemblance.
None at all.
But Roger, my sweet, use your eyes.
Mine are perfectly clear, Alicia, dearest. Yours, however, have been dulled by your excessive fondness for claret. You babble. No resemblance. Except perhaps one. We smell about the same. But then... I've been out for a frisky ride. What?
Do not prod me.
The French clock.
Roger, you will not. Take yourself and this brawling boor from this house.
As to which of us is the brawling boor, there is little doubt, my lady. Come, Mama.
Under the law. I could have you maimed for attacking me.
Well, then your laws are as worthless as you are.
You French bastard. I don't need the law. I'll see to your punishment myself, thoroughly and well.
I shouldn't venture to be too bold, Roger. He appears a match for your own hot temper, and striking him would be like striking yourself. He does have your good looks, after all. Perhaps he's a shade more handsome. I can't quite decide. Can you, Lady Jane?
Show them out.
That will not be necessary, my lady. We are happy to leave. We do, however, intend to stay in the village until Philip stands at the bedside of James Amberley and is recognized as his son.
My lady, an unexpected guest, Lord North.
Stand aside, if you please. Stand aside.
Why should I?
Why, sir? Because these good people believe some deference is due the Prime Minister of England.
You ignorant sod, this is Lord North.
And for this I should stand aside.
Yes, sir. That is essentially the reason.
Well, I do not give a damn who you are.
A trace of a French accent? Have we here a disciple of the infamous Rousseau?
Well, I have read him, yes.
And the pernicious Locke, too, no doubt.
Every word.
Then, as do they, hold you that the countryman has the same rights as the king, that the power of the former matches that of the latter?
Well, the truth, sir, is that the power of the people is the greatest power on earth.
Ah. But the king rules by divine right.
Well, then let him rule in heaven.
Lady Amberley, you have indeed attracted a perfect member of the mobility, as we call that rabble, over in our rebellious province of Massachusetts Bay. Though I do not make the habit of discoursing with commoners, I would advise you of one fact. Englishmen enjoy the fullest liberties of any race under the sun, but liberty is not a license to question the natural order of society. I know not how you caught this wicked disease of false libertarianism, but purge yourself before you come to disaster. Now, will you step aside?
Will you? Now that you have met them, Mama, is that really what you want me to be? Perhaps Gerard was right. Come, it is a long walk to the village.
Walk?
We will find no further favors here.
Spied you on Quarry Hill before.
Oh? Have you looked?
You have a saucy tongue, sir.
May I ask if there is any news of my father?
The situation's little changed. The Duke seldom wakens. They do fear for his life.
Thank you. We have very little knowledge of what goes on at Catland.
Unlike Lady Jane, who knows exactly what you do every minute.
Like this one?
No. Not this one.
Will you marry my brother?
Your brother? He'd like that.
Well, whether either of us likes it or not, it is fact.
I have no doubt. Yes, I shall marry Roger next year. The Amberley lands added to those of my father will leave an inheritance of increased size to children.
To children? With a man who humiliates you?
Larger concerns make things bearable.
Roger's fortune.
Exactly.
Is everyone who lives doomed to be a prisoner of something? Or someone?
If life be a prison, then we have no choice but to furnish it. Brightly. You realize, of course, that after Roger and I are married, I shall have to find lovers.
Of course. One husband is not enough.
Marriage has little relationship with more diverting pastimes. And I have often thought at best that Roger will be a crude lover, unlike the French, who we are told are experts in the art of love.
Then were you also thinking of indulging yourself in the novelty of finding out?
You speak our language very well.
I had a very good teacher.
And in Cupid's disciplines, have you had teachers too?
Enough. And you?
Oh, yes. Many.
Lady Parkhurst, it seems this conversation has wandered a very long way down an unfamiliar path.
Shall we turn back, Master Frenchman?
Can we?
I don't think so.
As I can. Need you wake the whole house?
All right, all right. Bishop Francis will speak to the Frenchwoman and her son.
I believe, and I'm sure you will agree, Madame Charbonneau, that the church must play the role of conciliator, the binder of wounds. And so I've come here to tell you that you are in a most enviable position. Lady Jane wishes you no particular harm and is willing to restrain her son Roger from possible evil. Were it up to him, he would as soon come to the village and murder your son, which, of course, under the law, is quite free to do.
That cannot be possible.
You would neither be accused nor troubled with an inquiry. Under the secular law, believe me, madame, in striking at the Amberleys, you were struck very high, very high. Such a family is all but invulnerable. No one in the realm would concern themselves with the chance demise of an itinerant French boy in the village. As the sparrow falls, God's eye is upon it. But alas, not the eyes of a magistrate. As for any claim you have against the eventual estate of the Duke, that is a matter for the courts. Lady Jane, in her position as Duchess of Kentland, can manage that no judgment be published for 10, 20, perhaps 30 years. And even then, the odds are it will go against you. Thus, at this moment, as you sit here, all you can expect is certain bodily harm at the hands of Roger Amberley. In your favor, only the good grace of Lady Jane. Now, to bring an end to this sorry affair, she's willing to grant you the sum of £2,000, which is a grand sum for those of you in at such a level of society, shall we say. This sum, in return for the renunciation of a claim to inheritance, and for the document itself.
2,000.
No.
Your son?
Philippe, what kept you?
I'm sorry, Mama. I did not mean to alarm you. But this man alarms me. Have they now enlisted the church against us?
I was just explaining the alternatives to accepting a most generous proposal from Lady Amberley.
Yes, I heard what you said.
Then I trust you understand that the facts of the matter are...
The facts are no different than when we first knocked at the door of Kentland. James Amberley is my father. The letter is legal. And I believe Lady Jane is afraid.
Oh, I can assure you...
What if I wait a few more hours, Bishop? What will the price be then? Huh? £5,000? 10,000?
I did not come here to negotiate.
Good. Because I will accept no less than what is rightfully mine. One half.
When a man decides to wait for a higher price, he should better first determine whether or not he can survive long enough to receive payment. Madame, you are my only hope in this affair. Talk to your son. Open his eyes. The consequences... Would you put a price on his death? Or show a mother's love and accept the settlement I have here for you now?
Philippe.
No, Mama.
I will not risk your life. Nothing is worth that. You have the entire sum?
Of course. But first I must see the document which lies at the heart of the dispute. It would be poor stewardship on my part not to assure myself of its authenticity.
Mama.
On Christian grounds, for all the suffering this will avoid, I could not be more pleased. It's £2,000. It will bring you comfort for many years. Isn't that what I promised you, Nancy?
Promised you in Paris? And it is dispatched with all my faith and affection. I rejoice in the birth of his son, whom you have named Philippe.
Stinking you. hypocritical bag of dust.
Here, what's going on?
Your Excellency. Sir? Sir, here, let me help you. Hold on.
Near the corner, the signature is still there.
I'll not have the likes of you under this roof another day.
We will not be staying. And you can tell the lady that holds your leash that we are coming to Kentland tomorrow. And I will see my father.
Impious whoreson. Hell take you for striking a man of the cloth.
As it has taken you already. Now get out of here before I break your fat neck.
Your Excellency, I pray you don't hold it against this humble house. You'll be out by morning, do you hear? By morning!
Philippe, I am pleased you remain firm. I was beginning to lose hope.
I swore to you an oath, Mama.
Household is in mourning, private mourning.
Let me in. Let me in!
Vulgar slattern.
Madam, you exceed the bounds of all decency. Leave at once and take this information with you. My husband woke briefly before he died. He charged me to care for his son. His legitimate son. He never mentioned your name, nor that of your boy. You have no claim on us. The matter is closed. No!
You French scum! My mother and seducing my fiance. Yes, she flaunted you, a French lover, French bastard.
Plumber, when you bring me his head, in a basket.
Is no highwayman. Driver! Stop the coach!
Philippe, I had to see you.
Why, Alicia? To cleanse your conscience.
One of the servants saw us together. He forced me to tell him. There was nothing I could do. Oh, forgive me. So glad I caught you. But you were right to leave. Dr. Bleeker says he can't save Roger's hand. If he ever sees you again, he'll kill you.
Then come with me, Alicia.
I can't. That was decided long before Quarry Hill.
want you, Alicia. I do not care about the money or Kentland. But I want you.
And I want you. I always will.
But you will not come with me.
To where? Oblivion?
Goodbye, Alicia.
Where can someone like you go?
Drive on!
Where?
Save the poor from the curse of prison!
Oh, only a few more steps, Mama. Wait here.
Be an inn.
We have not enough money for an inn, Mama. But the church doors will be open for mass at 6. We must wait.
Still here.
Told you, General. Little box might be jewelry. That long bundle of his might be a sword.
We'll have that. And a jewel box, too.
Get away. I said get away!
Oh, we caught ourselves a Frenchified rat what swam the channel.
All the more reason for him to surrender to His Majesty's subjects.
Give us them things, and there'll be no military reprisals against the lady! Get him!
Done. To whom should we explain that?
We'll explain this to no one. It's vermin squashed, and that's extremely good riddance.
Sir, we became aware of this hullabaloo as we came around yon corner. We saw that you were outnumbered.
Where's my mother?
Sir, your mother is being carefully guarded by our driver. Now, I am Esau Schulte, and this rather tipsy chap here is my brother Hosea.
I am most grateful.
Man's head is as hot as a kettle.
That slash on his neck needs dressing. I don't imagine we could just leave him here.
No, brother. I don't imagine we can at that. Up we go.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes. I think so.
I am Solomon Schulte. This is my wife, Emma. You've already met my two sons.
Where have you taken my mother?
Your mother is asleep upstairs. We must watch that cough of hers, but no doubt it will mend with rest. You're French, I understand, and were beset by those godless rascals who loiter at St. Paul's after dark. That's all we know. We know not even your name.
I'm called Philippe Charbonneau. My mother's name is Marie. I came from the province of Auvergne.
What brings you to the city? Come, sir, enlighten us. French people don't just pop up out of nowhere. Unless you're destined for hemp out on Tyburn Road, you have nothing to fear.
We came to England because of an inheritance.
Somehow connected with that box you guarded so carefully?
Yes. There is a letter inside. I would have you read it, sir.
Young man, we have no wish to pry.
So your son saved our lives. We are now in your very own house. You have the right, perhaps even the necessity of knowing exactly who we are. Read it.
He's in the Salter House, the printer's. He's been there for 2 days. Thanks, Governor, thanks.
Philippe, here.
Ink!
Coming, sir.
Exciting, isn't it?
Yes, it is, sir. Although I do not exactly know why.
Because this is a battle you can win. Well, it's not that I don't admire your audacity in challenging the Amberleys. But for every twisty-tongued lawyer you can buy, your Duchess can buy a baker's 12. And thugs of every ilk, should they be required. Babies from the wrong side of noble blankets on every street in London. But very few of them press their causes to advantage. And with the death of the Duke, I would say your cause is over. But here... here you stand in the very center of the battle of ideas, the promulgation of those precepts which will change the social order and bring kings tumbling down in favor of eventual democracy. That is what is exciting. That is the battle that counts, boy.
Don't bother. Looking for some fiction, a pleasant diversion.
Is he?
I don't know. He just came in. He's looking for some fiction.
His eye. I think I've seen him someplace before.
Where?
Kentland.
Are you certain?
No, but...
oh, Marie, oh, dear. You gave me a start. Oh, you had me seeing villains at every turn, too. I've a very impressionable mind, you know. Solomon always says I'm like the...
What is it?
He said fiction. This is Mr. Chambers' Cyclopedia Britannica.
It's enough, Philip. Break the coffin.
It's perfect. You must keep it. The first one you've spaced, typeset, everything all by yourself. You're really very good.
Thank you, sir.
I would say the aristocracy's loss is the printer's gain.
Oh, by the way, Philippe, I've been making some inquiries in the local coffee houses.
Concerning which gambling establishments are the most lenient with credit?
No, sir. Concerning the one-eyed man Madame Charbonneau thought she knew.
And?
There's been no report of him in the area.
Philippe, you don't recall seeing a one-eyed man at Kentland, do you?
No, sir, I do not.
After what happened there, your mother has a right to see danger at every turn. But I still think the Amberleys are satisfied you've surrendered to their power.
Well, yes, sir, except,
What?
Hosea and I have been talking. You don't find it rather strange that nothing at all has been said about Lord Amberley's death?
You and your brother don't exactly move in the circles which would be the first to know.
Yes, sir, but gossip is gossip. And other than the colonies, what else is there to talk about?
You must admit, sir, it is puzzling.
Well, the death of a husband, the claim of a bastard son, her own son losing the use of his hand. Who is to say how much these things may have taxed Lady Amberley's mind? They're a peculiar, twisted people. They may have chosen silence for some reasons known only to them.
Solomon! Solomon, you must come. We have a visitor.
Esau, Hosea. If any word of James Amberley comes to either of you during, well, during your rounds, I would appreciate hearing it.
Done.
Philip, you come up here too. A surprise. I promised to introduce you to a colonial. Your good fortune to meet one of such eminence. Dr. Benjamin Franklin. This young man is a guest in our household, a sort of unofficial apprentice. His name is Philippe Charbonneau. His mother, Madame Marie, is just beside you.
We met. My pleasure. Solomon, I have come here as a delegation of one to inform you that your presence is sorely missed at our gatherings in the Turk's Head and to assure you that the Whig Party is coming back to life over coffee cups.
Work has kept me away, but I'm most grateful for this delegation, and I promise to attend again later. I'm doubly glad that you're the emissary because I made a promise to Philippe here. Not only does he show an aptitude for the printing trade, but he's an avid reader, and he would dearly love a copy of your observations concerning the increase of mankind. My two library copies, alas, are both gone.
Well, then you shall come to my lodgings at number 7 on Craven Street, young man. Of an evening, preferably, and the book shall be yours. May I ask, however, the reason for your interest in my paper on population in America?
Well, sir...
Well, come, out with it.
Well, it is the New World, sir.
Aye, that it is. And would you be thinking of going there yourself?
Not seriously.
Oh, well, we'll change that. The opportunities there are unlimited, particularly for an ambitious young fellow who can ply a press. Before I rose to my present position of eminence... I was a printer myself, and I shall be happy to provide you with a letter of recommendation and a list of first-class printing houses where you can find meaningful employment. But we can discuss all of that when you come to call on me.
Thank you very much, sir.
And you, Solomon, rush orders or not, your friends will be expecting you at the Turk's Head within a fortnight. Uninterrupted work creates sour dispositions.
But wealthy printers.
Blast.
Thank you.
You should not be outside, Mama.
You are going to Dr. Franklin's?
Yes, I am.
You did not tell me about America.
Well, there has not been anything to tell, Mama.
Can you even entertain the idea of another country when there's wealth, position, power waiting for you right here in England?
Kentland, let it die, Mama.
You swore an oath.
I swore not to live and die in poverty. I found a worthy occupation, Mama, as a printer.
A tradesman? You are a nobleman.
Yes, Mama, yes. But right now I must go. I do not want to be late.
I do not care what Dr. Franklin says to you, what he promises.
He asked me to come, Mama. Me. He is a great man. I am flattered, that is all. Now, please, go inside. The damp is not good for you. I've come to see Dr. Franklin, but, well, maybe it is not the right time now.
Why not? If he received me in his condition, he should have no reason not to receive you. You do know him?
Oh, yes, madame. My name is Charbonneau, Philippe Charbonneau.
Madame. I like that. Dr. Franklin?
Yes, Polly, my girl? Changed your mind, have you?
No, sir. You have a caller. A young gentleman says he knows you. A Master Charbonneau.
Oh, yes, yes. By all means, show him in.
Over there.
Thank you very much.
He's having his air bath.
Ah! Charbonneau, good of you to come. Have a chair. Help yourself to some of that Madeira. I'll be through with my air bath in just a few moments. I have always believed that fresh air gives a salubrious effect to a man's health and longevity. Thus, I throw open the windows and bathe in this fashion for 1 hour every day. But enough of poor Richard's remedies. You've come about America. Time is up. Pour me a glass as well, huh? Can I close these windows? Where do you make your home? France, if I guess the accent.
Yes, sir. I'm from the province of Auvergne. We came to England on business.
when my father died. I was supposed to receive an inheritance, but, well, there were complications.
Some pack of rascally relatives cut you off, huh?
You are quick to get to the heart of it, sir.
So now your thoughts turn west, across the sea. Good choice. Good choice. In America, a man is free to rise as far and as fast as his wits and wisdom will permit. We are spared the constraints of the antique European custom of nobility and privilege. I would say that America in the immediate future represents a unique combination of opportunity and risk. Yes, risk. You see, the good King German George simply fails to understand the American temper. We seek only justice, not enmity. But if he continues to force the issue with his infernal taxes and decrees, well then, Mr. Charbonneau, you will see 13 colonies pull and haul together as they have never done. We shall have justice. We have to light the fire and forge it ourselves. More Madeira. If I'm not depressing you, I am depressing myself. And you want to have a look at that book I promised, eh? Inside, you will find the promised letter of recommendation. Thank you. And a list of good printing houses in the major cities. In America, you should establish yourself in no time at all.
You have been unbelievably kind to me, sir.
I can do no less for a marked man. I myself am considered subversive by the Crown. And to travel Craven Street is deemed dangerous. Yeah. I saw him before when I closed the windows. Now look carefully at the next flash. Still want to take up with us Americans?
Yes, sir, I think so.
Good boy. Come, I'll conduct you out the rear for your own safety.
Here's a present from the man you maimed.
As it looks. One inch to the left.
Are you quite sure it's the man who came here?
Yes. Hired by the Amberleys.
But the very fact they sought you, Philippe, proves they fear your claim.
Mama, they are powerful enough to strike down any claim they wish just by manipulating the law. It is me Roger wanted, in payment for what I did to him, pure and simple. Revenge. And even if I'd killed his one-eyed assassin, he would just send another one, and then another, until the task was finished. Mama, we cannot repay the Sholtos for their kindness by exposing them to danger. We must leave London.
Philippe, let us suppose they anticipate your flight. All the Channel ports will be watched. Every passage to France.
Yes, sir, I know that. We will go in the other direction.
The colonies?
I can find employment there, Esau. Especially with the letter from Dr. Franklin. My mother has been saving money.
Never! That money is for the lawyers, for the claim. I will not go. I will not.
Mama, it is my life thereafter. And if you want me here, then you want me dead. Tomorrow morning, we go to Bristol City.
Mm-hmm.
horse, sir. You could be a road captain.
Out, all of you. Keep your wits about you and hand us your valuables and you'll not get hurt. Right, Captain?
Well said. Now, I be Captain Plummer, at your service. All you passengers on the roof, step down. I said down, especially you, Mr. Frenchman.
There's one left, Captain, a woman.
Drag her out.
I be Lucas, sir.
Philippe.
A keen shot, that. There's no shame in it, sir. When the time comes, you kill easily. Then there will be shame.
Tell me where I might find a Captain Kaling.
Over there, mate.
Thank you. Excuse me, sir. Are you Captain Kaling?
Aye.
The man on your ship said that I would find you here.
I have a full crew already, son.
Well, I'm not seeking employment, sir. I need passage. And you are sailing for America, no?
There's one small cabin.
Just one.
50 quid.
50 quid? I'm sorry, sir. I do not know how much that is. We have only £7.
We?
Oh, yes, my mother and I. It is all the money we have.
Are you sure she's up to the crossing?
It is imperative we go, sir.
Not in trouble, are you? A runaway bond servant?
No, I am a free man.
French?
My mother is. My father was English.
Well, I don't know, lad. Like I said, there's only the one cabin.
We will take it, sir. That is, if the money will buy it. And if it will not, I would gladly work anything you need done.
Have you sailed before?
Sailed? Well, sir, as you know, the English Channel lies between my mother and my father. Well, of course, many times. No, sir, I've not sailed. Well, except to come here for the first time a few weeks ago, and well, the sea was so heavy I did not make the voyage well at all. But I will work, sir. I will work harder than anyone on the crew, please.
You know what a scullery looks like?
Well, I was brought up at an inn. I've served table all my life. I can clean pot like nobody and scrub the floors, the tables, the stove. I will keep things spotless for you, sir. That is a promise.
What's your name, lad?
Philippe Charbonneau.
You said your father's English.
Yes, sir, I did. I am a bastard. But I am told there is a place for every man in America.
Fetch your mother and your money. You'll sleep aboard tonight and serve the morning meal under sail.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I'm very grateful. Thank you, sir.
Mama? Mama, he will take us. He's going to let me work for part of the passage money.
Mama, we are going.
Look, I will give him the £7 now.
Mama, the letter from Dr. Franklin, it is missing. I must have lost it during the fighting. Mama, we must find it.
You cannot go back for it. Not ever. You must go on alone.
Oh, no, Mama.
I cannot help anymore, Philippe. But you must go. And remember your oath, Philippe. Remember the promise you made to me.
Mr. Charbonneau? Coming?
Yes, sir. We are coming. Come, Mama. Quickly now. Standing here, please sit. Look, I brought you some soup. It is not so bad today.
No, no. I cannot. Believe. Help me.
Sorry to bother you, sir.
Some difficulty, lad?
My mother, sir. She is not well, as you know. Well, it is the sickness she has had before, but now it is worse. Much worse. Is there anyone on the ship who has medical skill?
The Eclipse is a commercial vessel. We can't afford the luxury of a doctor.
Seems I made the wrong choice.
What man doesn't, almost hourly? Do you have any idea of what might ail your mother?
Fever. She coughs quite a bit. Her lungs are weak, I know that, but... Well, I fear it is something else now, sir.
What?
I'm afraid it is her mind, too.
Her mind?
It is as though she's lost the will to live. I do not know. Maybe it is the strain, the idea of going somewhere else to start all over again as a stranger. I took her below, sir. But she still refuses to eat. I have to do something.
I'm sorry, son. There's no way I can turn the Eclipse back to England. Three degrees starboard.
Thank you.
Yes, Mama.
Do not light the light. I know I must look.
Mama. Mama, look. Look, I've made you something. I found a piece of wood.
They could never go to church. Not after Paris. Not after you. They would not let me. So long ago. So long. I will never reach this America of yours.
Do not say that.
I no longer have the strength.
You have to help yourself to live.
To what purpose? Your father is dead. So is everything I hope for you. That wicked family.
Not now, Mama.
You made the right decision, Philippe. A new country. You are young and you have the heart for it. You have done the right thing.
Mama, we will talk about it later. Now, right now, you should get some rest.
Once I made you swear an oath, a hopeless oath. You must forget that, Philippe. Forget that. I now beg you only for a promise.
What, Mama?
Promise me that in the new land, you will strive to be a man of position, a man of wealth. Then someday you can return to England and repay them, damn their arrogant souls.
I promise you that, Mama. I promise.
And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also, and whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Amen. Too much to do with lawyers and their contracts and agreements. In my opinion, this document is as binding as one could be in the civilized world. Not that you could ever enforce it. Point is, your half-brother can never rest until he knows that this is destroyed. It can only haunt him. Ahead of you lies the new world, the new life. Why not start as a new man entirely? a new identity, a new name. Think upon it.
Yes, sir, I will.
I must be back to the helm. Philippe, to lose the woman who gives you life, that's no easy thing. My mother's 87, healthy and peppery as ever up in Maine. I hope when she passes, I can behave as you did. You took it as a man.
Times, Philippe. Always gives me a shiver.
Yes, I felt that shiver too, sir. But it is no longer Philippe. From now on, I am Philip Kent.
Aye, Mr. Kent, so be it. Not every man gets the chance to be born twice. Make the most of it.
Aye, sir. I will. Philip Kent. Philip Kent. Philip Kent.
I see you've come true in love.
Well, I was just wondering, sir.
If you were in the right part.
No, which way to go?
Part what?
Work.
Hey, well, best you could do for yourself in that case is heave to and sign on again with Will Caleb there. No finer skipper in all New England.
I'm afraid the sea is not for me, sir.
Oh, well, Boston might not be either. Times are hard.
I will make it.
Alone?
Aye.
Wherever you're from, you're a born Yankee, all right. Godspeed to you, lad.
Thank you.
And may the wind ever be at your back.
I'm sorry. I wish I knew of something for you. Have you tried Mr. Rankin?
Rankin? No, ma'am.
Well, if anybody has work, he would. The Blue Anchor Tavern across the way.
Thank you very much.
Should have thought of that before your ship left. I don't know anybody in town that's looking for help.
Thank you.
And what can I serve you, young sir?
Well, sir, I was looking for work.
Ah, no work? Sorry.
I would work for scrap, sir.
I already got one of them. Right, Jeremy?
Aye, sir.
Sorry, lad.
Oaf dirtied my trousers. Then we shall make him pay for a laundress, Captain. You, come around to the headquarters of the 14th West Yorkshires in the morning. And I want you to bring sufficient money so that... Pay attention when a king's officer gives you an instruction. Unless you prefer the message be delivered in a more memorable way. Ah, a scrapper. Ah, that is fine with me. He's probably sporting a Liberty Medal under those stinking clothes. He's certainly insolent enough to be one of them. Do I have your leave to thin their ranks slightly, sir?
As you wish.
Paul! Stay your hand, sir. You've made one mistake, sir. No need to make another. What started this, lad?
Well, sir, I happened to splash mud on the captain's trousers. It was an accident.
Sir, you see what he's done to my face?
Improved it considerably, I'd say. I would remind you where you are, sirs. The salutation is crowded with good friends, but if you truly wish to engage, I can guarantee a substantial part of the North End would be here after your heads before three blows are struck.
Leave off, Stark. Sir, I refuse to cower in front of these... I said leave off, or you'll have a cut on your throat to match the one on your face. One of these days, we'll have laws to hang you rebel scum.
Aye, there'll be hangings right enough. But it'll be your necks that are stretched under the Liberty Tree. Good work, lad. Come along. Oh, and thank you, Franz. And there'll be one round of drinks served in the salutation. Compliments of Will Campbell. Here you are, lad. A mug of ale for you. And Jeremy, fetch a goodly bowl of chowder from the kitchen and some brown bread.
Aye, sir.
That go well with you, lad?
You will never know, sir.
Well, we do know it was a bold thing you did out there. Most men would have truckled, I can tell you.
Well, sir, I may have acted out of ignorance. I've only just come to Boston City.
And half dead from the experience, no doubt.
Well, I have been trying to find work, sir.
Ah. What's your name, lad?
Philip Kent, sir.
Runaway bondsman?
No, sir, a free man.
Can you prove it?
Only with my word.
I think maybe there's something we can find for you to do here at the salutation. Every young lad who tweaked Tommy's beak, eh?
You could use a new roof, Will.
Aye, that I could, Ben. Are you good at carpentry, Philip Kent?
Well, I'm sure I could learn, sir. I have used a hammer.
Good.
But, well, what I really am is a printer.
What's that? A printer?
Yes, sir.
You served your apprenticeship, did you?
With Sholto and Sons, London.
Sholto? Will? Let your roof leak. I'll take this one off your hands. If he is indeed a printer.
Say hello to Benjamin Eads, lad, of Eads and Gill.
Well, I'm a bit out of practice, sir. I'm certain I could work faster.
Do you have a place to live?
No, sir, I do not.
I suppose we could put a cot in the cellar?
Well, thank you, sir, very much.
There's hard work here.
Dangerous work, judging by what's written here. The Gazette, what is it?
A Voice of Dissent.
And this author, Joyce Jr.?
That's a pseudonym for Samuel Adams.
Samuel Adams?
He's a leader of what the Tories call mobility.
Well, I am familiar with that term, sir. Lord North once accused me of being a member.
Lord North?
Yes, sir. The Prime Minister of England.
You had an audience with him?
Well, more of a chance encounter at my father's house.
Now, see here, Philip. I must say I find it hard to believe that the lad who just arrived here in Boston penniless had an audience with the Prime Minister of England.
Well, sir, it is true.
You mind telling me how?
Well, sir, my father was English, a nobleman. I am his son by a French woman he never married. A bastard son. I was to receive part of a fortune, and when I went to England to claim it, his family tried to kill me. So I escaped to America.
Your mother is French. Why don't you go to her?
She is dead too, sir. But, well, in London, I got to like being a printer. Being in the battle of ideas, as Mr. Sholto would say.
And Dr. Franklin told me that I could find employment...
Franklin? Benjamin Franklin?
Yes, sir.
For God, a prime minister and Ben Franklin, too?
Well, sir, I believe it was Dr. Franklin's feelings about freedom that convinced me to come here most of all.
The preservation of freedom requires a struggle. And more importantly, secrecy. How long have you been in America?
3 days, sir. Barely.
Man will never know whether he finds fortune or fortune finds him. But you must know that you have stumbled into something beyond your imagining.
The Sons of Liberty.
Our meeting place, the back room of the Salutation. This press, our spokesman. Our purpose, the guarantee of liberty. There's great risk here, son. Are you prepared to accept it?
Yes, sir, I am.
Good. Then let us get a tot of rum while we haggle over the inequitable price that I'm going to pay for your services.
Young Crosspot, let the brush to him now!
Striking a boy!
What is it, sir?
Johnny Malcolm.
Well, who's Johnny Malcolm?
He's a harmless old lunatic.
Backbiting scum! You are here because the King of England saw fit to colonize this wonderful land. And you betrayed him! He gave you your home, gainful employment, and laws to abide by.
Wend your tongue, Johnny Malcolm, or we'll put the tar brush to it before we put it to your backside.
It'll be. He's just a senile old man.
He means no harm.
Tend to your cream punch, Smithy. He bullied the Williams boy, and that's a fact. Upset his kindling cart for no reason at all.
Well, you don't go to Hades, a lot of you. And I will push over that little warts wagon whenever I have a mind. I know his father is spreading sedition in Boston City. And if I split his head open, I will get 10 shillings from the governor himself. I will get double that for all you Yankee traitors.
You had a taste of the tar and feathers once, Johnny. This time we'll do it properly.
Stand aside, Smithy.
Diamond Man, if you're a friend of liberty, leave off torturing a helpless enemy.
Get out of the way.
Hit him back, Smithy. Hit him back.
Have you no sense, man? Have you no idea what you do to the cause?
Cause? You give me cause, sir.
Who's a fool? Liberty! You would give these dogs liberty! You would unleash these dogs!
They do you some damage?
Nothing permanent.
Animals to revel in such savagery in the name of liberty.
One of Mr. Adams' mobs?
All they want is cruel sport. There's not a man in that pack who wears the Liberty Medal. Ben, get out a statement. Let Boston know he had nothing to do with this, and we'll see to those that did.
Done.
Thank you for the hand, young man. Name is Revere, Paul Revere.
Mr. Revere, Philip Kent.
Paul is our resident silversmith. More importantly, he's the one man among us who can reach out to the artisans and mechanics in the town.
Because I'm one myself. If you ever need a silver button replaced, Mr. Kent, my shop is on Clark Street.
Well, I'm afraid I do not have many of those yet, sir.
Yet? Spoken like a real Yankee, Ben.
I think you'll find that he's one of us in many ways.
I hope so. See you at the salutation, Ben.
Right.
How say you, Mr. Kent? Having felt the sting of a mob, do you have second thoughts about working with the men who incite them to action?
The truth, sir? I do not know if I'm ready to fight for your cause, but I think I understand it.
Better than most, I imagine. England looks at all of us here as her bastard sons. We feel we are her true sons. We will somehow prove that. Welcome to America, Mr. Kent. And to a common cause.
Will you see the rest of the pamphlets over to Goodale's by 6?
Yes, sir.
That's one more thing done. Seems to be more and more to do.
Yes, it does that, sir.
Lucky we met that day, Philip. You've been of great service to me. You've also earned the respect and trust of others. Will Campbell, in particular.
Mr. Campbell, at the salutation?
He wondered whether you'd mind to serve the flip to the Sons of Liberty.
Me, sir?
Aye, in the back room. There's a few pence in it, a little extra money. What do you say?
Well, do I have a chance to serve men like Samuel Adams, sir? I would be most honored.
Good, I'll pass that along. And don't forget, Goodale's by 6.
Yes, sir.
Was that Mr. Reed's driving off?
Yes, it was.
Oh, damn.
Well, is there something I can help you with?
Are you a new apprentice?
Well, I worked for Mr. Reed's on wages, but I'm not bound to him or to anyone.
This is copy from my father to be set immediately. I trust the writing has your approval?
Yes, it seems excellent. And I agree with your father's appeal to establish a committee of correspondence, Mistress Ware.
Do you? I wasn't aware an ordinary devil approved or disapproved copy.
I will pass this material on to Mr. Eads the moment he returns. Good day.
Thank you. I did address you sharply. But this article's very important.
The matter of Mr. Hancock's reluctance to give his support to Mr. Adams' plan? Yes, I would say that is terribly important. But I'm sure your father's usual fine phrasing will help persuade him.
You're familiar with his writing?
If we print it, I read it.
My name is Philip Kent.
As soon as the material has been proofed, my father would welcome a message to that effect. If you will so notify Mr. Eads.
Please.
What?
If you will so notify Mr. Eads to that effect, please.
Nervous?
Why, sir?
Well, don't be letting the gentleman inside see that, young. Could be mistaken for something else.
Sir?
If any of the words spoken behind that door were to be repeated, a lot of men's lives could be in jeopardy. And if you seem like the kind of person that might let something slip, so to speak, one of those lives could be your own. Still want to go in?
Yes, sir.
They must be harnessed together, which is the purpose of the Committee of Correspondence.
I will vouch for the trustworthiness of this young man.
Samuel, this is the young man I mentioned, Philip Kent.
Ah, yes. Friend of Dr. Franklin's.
Well, sir, an acquaintance. And very much in his debt for encouraging me to come here.
Well, we can always use recruits. And from what Benjamin here tells me, you've no love for the nobility.
Not to those who treat ordinary people like property, sir.
There is no other kind of nobility.
You have a foolish consistency, Samuel. We have friends. Like the Earl of Chatham, you can't just dismiss him because he's an earl.
Principius obsta, Dr. Warren. Principius obsta. Take a stand at the start. The first appeasement only leads to others. Be assured of that. And at the very moment that we have no issue to stir up the citizens of Boston to our purpose, we are delivered with two. Two! Since June. And yet, you hesitate. It is unforgivable.
No, Campbell. Let him stay. If we hear any of our remarks abroad tomorrow, we'll know who to blame.
We can trust him.
He was with Mr. Eads and myself when the mob ran poor Johnny Malcolm into the tar pit. He stood with us, against a lot of them.
Yes, well, there you have the crux of the problem. Now, how the devil can it be us against them when we all sink or swim together?
The only answer is to provoke them.
I don't think it possible to provoke a populace that's grown complacent with the present prosperity.
It is possible. We must hammer at them daily with issues.
Yes, such as the announcement by the Royal Governor Hutchinson that commencing next year, his salary will be paid not by the provincial Congress, but by the Crown.
The working man doesn't care who pays the governor. And since these last taxes have been rescinded...
But not the damn tea tax.
Well, now there, we have a thorn for everyone's side. Magnified out of all proportion if we have to. But use that single issue to seize advantage. Confrontation and conflagration will surely follow. Now, as soon as the citizens understand that and accept it...
Samuel, you are a manipulator. And I will never agree that conflagration, your prettified term for open rebellion, for war, is inevitable.
Well, then, sir, you are blind.
No, sir, you are a manipulator. You are determined to take us to war.
German George dictates our course. And I say, let it be the last dictate that he delivers to these colonies.
Samuel is right, Philip. Dr. Warren may say what he will, but it's there for all of us to see. We are headed for war.
I'm sure it's an inconvenience, Mr. Ware. It is to all of us, particularly to Sergeant Lumden. But I'm sure we'll all get used to the arrangement. Other homes have, and more will. And you do have room to accommodate at least one of us, if anyone does.
I'm sure you must know I conduct a goodly portion of my business from my home, though, Captain. I can't be having strangers about while clients are discussing confidences.
We are well acquainted with your business, Lawyer Ware, and your political persuasion. But there will be no breach of faith as a result of the sergeant living with you as long as you keep faith with the Crown. And as for strangers, well, perhaps I might put your mind at rest on that score by permitting me to call upon your daughter.
It isn't my permission that's needed in that matter, Captain Stark. It's the young lady's.
And the granting of that is an impossibility.
You have no control over your daughter's behavior, sir.
Excuse me. We have a visitor, sir. Oh, it's Mr. Kent from the printing house. Do come in, Mr. Kent. I believe you know my father.
Yes, indeed. How do you do, sir?
And this is our new house guest, Sergeant Ludmer, was it?
Lumden, mum.
House guest?
Oh, well, just for a while, mum. You see...
Lumden!
Sir!
Mr. Ware expects no apology. I'm sure none is owed his servant.
Sorry, sir. I only thought, did I?
See to your quarters and your tongue.
Yes, sir.
The spare room, Daisy?
Yes, ma'am.
Follow me.
Very nice to meet you, sir.
Oh, and you, Sergeant.
And this is Captain Sparks.
Stark. Yes, I believe we've met before. Congratulations on your promotion, Captain.
Your daughter keeps company with mechanics?
By preference.
Boston is not so large that we will not meet again, mechanic.
My pleasure.
Your servant.
They all think their uniforms make them the catch of the day. Our thanks to you, Mr. Kent. We couldn't get rid of him, even with outright rudeness.
I thought your greeting was for practical purposes.
How is it you're acquainted with a lobster back, Mr. Kent?
We argued once, sir.
About what?
The scar on his face.
Did you put it there?
I've brought the proofs for you, Mr. Ware. I hope it wasn't too untimely.
Not at all, lad. I'm anxious to look at them.
I suppose I should apologize for my behavior at the printers.
I suppose you should.
I don't like...
I accept. Oh, you told the captain that you kept the company of mechanics by preference. And I intend to hold you to your admission. Might I call upon you some Sunday, perhaps for a walk on the common, or I could rent a boat?
It seems I have trapped myself, haven't I?
It seems so, Mistress Anne.
You are impertinent.
But tell your father that I will be back in an hour for those proofs. And I will call for you on Sunday. Have you by chance made the acquaintance of Lawyer Ware's daughter?
Anne Ware? What about her?
Oh, I was just wondering.
Nice looking young woman. Inclined to have a sharp tongue.
Yes, so I discovered.
It's my opinion that Abraham has allowed her too free an access into his library. It's going to take a man with backbone and a large fist to wed and bed that one. She's already past marriageable age. No regular beau, as much to her father's chagrin. I think he fears she may become a spinster.
Well, sir, I find it hard to believe that someone isn't courting her.
Would you like a wife smarter than you?
Well, I never considered it, sir. Oh, by the way, Miss Treats, would it be possible for you to grant me, say, a small advance on my wages?
I find no inhibiting consideration. You want to buy something?
Yes, sir.
Benjamin? This must be printed up immediately. Outrageous affront to Englishmen's liberties.
What's this?
Well, it's happened. Rumors are true. Lord North is inviting disaster, and he's giving us precisely what we hope for.
In what manner?
With tea. Cutter brought the news this morning. A bill passed in London not a month ago, granting the East India Company a virtual monopoly in the colonial tea trade. Even paying taxes on this side, the company can undercut the prices of law-abiding Tory merchants.
But why would the Crown strike at the merchants, the very heart of the element that supports it?
Because they're fools. But they did do it and gave us a weapon to turn even the most loyal followers of the king against him. Now we have an issue with real teeth. And they're going to feel the bite of it. Every man jack of them. I promise you, in a year, perhaps less, we'll have what we wanted.
War.
Precisely.
I think Mr. Adams is right. The people of all the colonies are going to have to make a choice. Whatever happens in Boston is eventually going to happen everywhere. At least some progress is being made. My father says there's a man named Jefferson from Virginia who's as committed as any man to the cause.
And what about you? Are you committed?
Yes, I am.
Why?
Because of your father?
I have other reasons.
Meaning?
I intend that liberty should apply to me too. Not just to men. Why should I have to retreat from the world just because I'm a woman?
The lady sounds angry.
There has to be more to life than having babies and kitchens and seeing polish on hardwood floors.
Plunging into politics?
Hoping to be part of my husband's work someday. When I know who he is.
What's the matter?
I've loved no man yet, Philip. Not that way.
I want you, Anne.
I want you too.
Then
there has to be more. I'm sorry.
I am too. I cannot give you what you need, Anne. Not now.
Because you don't know if what you need is here or back in England? Someday you'll know, Philip. I can wait.
Threatened with us more time than I can count.
It was the Tories, then.
Oh, they're too afraid of the Sons of Liberty to risk after dark villainy. They know they'd likely never get home again. It would be the soldiers coming across from the garrison at Castle William.
The Right Honorable King's Men.
Thinking that they might silence our protests over the tea with a little hooliganism. Well, we'll have to print again tomorrow. They appear to have destroyed about a third of the run.
We came close to destroying the only place I have to build a future.
Here. You've earned this tonight. Wear it proudly. Noble birth or not, you're one of us now. And it's time we all took action.
Fine.
There's enough for 10 men here.
Well, I do not think blankets and feathers will fool anyone.
We're not trying to fool anyone, Philip, but there are men with us who can't afford to risk discovery.
Besides, these rags can be shed quickly if we have to run for them.
It's Captain Ross. There he is. Quiet! Hear what he says.
Captain, have you called upon the governor?
Oh, I have.
And what is his disposition in this matter?
His Excellency repeated that he cannot give me a pass to sail from the harbor unless my vessel is cleared from the customs house, with the duty on the tea paid.
No! 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 No!
Silence!
Captain, it is the will of the citizens that your cargo of tea be returned to England. We will not have it on our shore.
Help it! Help it!
However, if you do not sail on the next tide, the Crown claims the right to seize your vessel and the tea. Therefore, sir, you must sail.
I cannot possibly do so. It would prove my ruin to pay the tax.
Well, then it would seem we have but one choice.
to find out how well tea mingles with salt water. No matter what transpires, from this time forward, let it be remembered that no one shall attempt any harm on the good captain here or his vessel. Now to the harbor! Let's brew some tea!
So, did you have a fine evening for your Indian raid? Well, the mechanic. I thought I recognized you under that blanket. Not only do you insult His Majesty's officers, but you flout his laws. I guess I could bring you in front of a magistrate, but I think I would prefer a more personal justice. And while you're rotting here with the dogs picking over your bones, I will be calling upon the young lady again. Think of that while you're bleeding to death, eh? Oh.
Waited till Father was asleep.
What about the sergeant?
He was called to the harbor.
Anne, you cannot be found on the streets tonight of all nights. I will see you home.
No. Philip, I saw you leave. I thought what could happen. I had to... Philip.
It is nothing.
You're bleeding.
Anne, let's go.
I won't leave you like this.
Anne.
Inside, Philip. Inside. We heard there'd be no trouble at Griffin's Wharf.
There wasn't.
This is from a knife or a sword.
It has no relation to Mr. Adams' tea party. It's just something that happened, and it's over now.
Oh, Philip. All I could think about when I saw you leave tonight is how I've been prattling on about the future. When the most obvious thing is that we may not have any future at all.
Anne.
Tonight, I knew what I had to do. To come here and say what I've never said to anyone before.
Anne, I don't think...
I want you, Philip. Without any conditions, or promises, or pledges about tomorrow. I want you. Even if it's only for this one night.
Take well to the militia.
Well, thank you very much, sir. My father was a soldier.
This is a reserve company. We have three units which we consider front rank. If you'd be interested, I could propose you for one of those.
I would consider it a privilege, Colonel Knox.
You would, of course, be required to supply yourself with a musket. The current brown Bess in use by the King's men would do nicely. We're not overly curious how a man acquires a gun so long as he has one, if you follow me.
I do indeed, sir.
Colonel Knox, your wife sent me with this. It was just posted.
Damn them to hell.
What is it, sir?
New bill just passed Parliament. The province of Massachusetts is to be punished for destroying the tea.
As well as for her long and open rebelliousness against Crown authority in general. This bill forbids the loading or unloading of any cargo in Boston Harbor effective June 1st, 1774.
We've received reports that the British Naval Squadron is already seeing to the completeness of the blockade.
We'll survive. The city can be supplied by land across the neck. New York, the other colonies are sure to help.
I pray God you're right. If that's not the case, these intolerable acts will mean the end of Boston.
The end? On the contrary. Do you know what the outcome will be if the ministers continue to make laws to punish us? Do you know where the road will lead?
Armed resistance.
More than that. United resistance.
And then, independence.
I speculated who among us would be the first to speak that word.
What made you say that, son?
I do not know, sir. A talk I had with a friend, I suppose.
I guess it's been on all of our minds. I suppose it's been on Samuel's mind the longest, eh, sir?
It has. And I will accept nothing less.
It is not as much as Samuel or Dr. W, or indeed myself, would have wished. On the other hand, to be here in Philadelphia, to be among the delegates who foregather at City Tavern at nightfall, and to hear such gentlemen as the very respected Colonel Washington of Virginia voice the same concerns as the men of Boston. That, my dearest daughter, is an experience not capable of being fully described, only savored in the proud heart.
Your father's a good man. You must be proud he was chosen.
Yes, I am. And so is he.
Does he say when he might return?
No. Thankfully. As much as I miss him, I think I'd miss this time alone more.
We'd best get back.
In time.
Anne. We can't.
Yes, we can. Daisy?
Cover it.
Miss Anne? Miss Anne?
Don't think ill of Daisy, Mistress Ware, or you, Mr. Kent, sir. It was me who made her.
George!
I mean...
It's all right, Daisy, it's all right.
I just don't know what got into her, sir. I mean, into me. I took complete advantage of the poor girl. Oh, Daisy, please forgive me. Please forgive me.
George, get up.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, my love. I'm sorry now. Truth is, Mistress Ware, I've been meaning to speak to you for quite some time now. If I could speak in confidence.
Well, of course you can, Sergeant.
That's it. The sergeant part. That's what's wrong. What's between us? This blasted army. I'm going to leave it.
You know, it's treason to talk that way.
I'm not talking about resigning.
Desertion?
Sir, when I first came to Boston, even though I hated the fact I was here to repress fellow Englishmen, I would have struck down any chap who said I might run away. But I don't mind admitting that my feelings for Daisy have changed my attitude about everything. We're going to be married, sir.
My father has a farm, other side of Concord. George could hide there.
And what about your uniform?
Huh? Burn the uniform, I guess.
And the musket.
Musket?
Musket and bayonet. My price for seeing you safely to Concord.
It's yours, Mr. Kent.
Philip.
Philip. Yes, sir.
You'll need a plan to get out of Boston.
Well, you said we were going to a farm, so we'll go as farmers. Of course, we'll need different clothes, perhaps a horse and a cart. We could speak to Will Campbell at the Salutation, see if he could help us out.
How much you figure it costs?
I'd say about 5 shillings should do it.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now then, who is the man?
I don't know his name, sir. I only know he's quartered in Lawyer Ware's house on Launder Street.
That would be Sergeant Lumden, sir.
A sergeant, aye. Mr. Campbell's getting the cart for him in Kent. I must go, sir.
Kent?
Sir?
The traitor, he calls himself Kent?
Aye, sir.
Describe him.
Sir?
His height, his likeness, his age. Describe him.
Jeremy, you are right, lad.
Aye, sir. Just slapped a bit over on the gentleman's sleeve while I was cleaning off the table.
Be careful.
Kent, tell me.
20, maybe. Not too big nor too small. Fair of color. I don't know, sir.
How long has he been in Boston?
In Boston, sir?
Talk, lad. And straightward. I'll have your tongue.
The first time I saw him was over a year ago. I told Mr. Campbell he'd come in from Bristol on a freighter.
Bristol? You're certain he said Bristol?
Aye, sir. Bristol it was. I've got to go, sir.
What is it, Colonel? Are you all right? Colonel Amberley, what is this fellow Kent? Do you know him?
The highwayman who left my hand this way. I'm told he calls himself by that name. And I know he fled from Bristol.
Well, by God, we shall bring him in, then.
No need, Major. I can take him alone.
What if the deserter is with
him? I said I'll deal with it alone, Major.
As you wish, sir.
It's time. It's time that both our troops and the citizens of Boston learn the price of betrayal. I intend this incident to become a lesson. And I shall teach it personally.
Philippe Charbonneau. Where is he?
I told you I don't know anyone by that name.
But you know the name Kent, don't you? Philip Kent.
Get out.
Oh, is he your lover? He has a way with women, I'm told. My wife was his lover once. Did he tell you about her?
You're hurting me.
And your Frenchman never hurts you? Strange. At least he told me he hurt her. Very deeply, she said, by leaving her after he'd known her pleasure.
Please.
Now, where is he?
Get down, sir. Get down.
What is it?
Sir, an officer. Inside with Mistress Ware. Daisy saw him coming up. I run out the back to hide. They know. They know.
Mr. Campbell would never tell anyone. Jeremy, the boy who works for him in the Salutation. He was sweeping up. He must have heard us.
Sold us out.
George, wait. Wait.
Stay here.
He did that to me. And he took Alicia while she was betrothed to me. What do you think I'll do to him?
My father...
Your father will do nothing. The general staff knows how this house is used to hatch treason. But perhaps when your lover learns what sweet pleasures I've taken here, he'll be as eager to seek his revenge as I am mine. Charbonneau.
Outside. I will not spill your blood in this house.
You dare to take the name Kent? I wrote Alicia about finding you. Told her about your long overdue death.
sorry.
Your brother?
He was many things to me, but never a brother. Anne, are you all right?
Yes. But he knew about you and about Sergeant London.
If anyone comes here looking for him, your story must be that he never arrived. You never saw him, you never heard his name before they mentioned that. Do you understand?
Yes, but what if I can't convince them? What if they...
Anne, we must move quickly and surely. Now, please, go find Daisy, get her to help you make things neat again. And London and I will get rid of his body.
You can't still go to Concord.
Not as we planned, anyway. If they know about us, then they know about the clothes and the cart. Now, hurry, please, get Daisy in London.
George, hurry. I just saw some soldiers a ways back.
You know where to leave the cart?
Yes.
Mr. Kent. Listen, Terry.
Keep your pace. Everything tallies. This must be it.
I wish Daisy would give me some kind of token, something that your father would recognize as hers.
Word that she is safe is all you'll need to hear.
That be far enough.
We are friends.
Not by the courts on your backs.
I knew it. Daisy told me her father would just as soon shoot me as meet me in this uniform.
Be quiet, George. The coat's a borrowed, friend. We come from Boston. From Daisy O'Brien.
Mine whose name rolls off your tongue so lightly in her father's presence, Major. I don't give a tinker's damn about your rank or about the crown you bought it from. You were asked to state your business. Well, state it and be gone with you.
Mr. O'Brien, we are not at all what we seem, sir. Our real clothes are in Mr. London's pack.
You were told to stand fast.
Sir, look, this tear and the stain. I have no wound, sir, because the uniform is not mine.
To what end do you wear it, then?
Well, to seek shelter, sir. And Daisy told us we'd be safe here. Oh, well, and this, sir... Well, this was just to get us here without question. My name is Kent. Philip Kent.
Sir? Master Charbonneau.
Lucas?
It is you. How you be?
I am well, Lucas. Much better now.
You know this man?
I do that.
But not by the name he gave me.
No, sir, but then I've had more than one name myself. But this man and I, We had one grand time on the Bristol Road about 2 years ago, sir.
Well, a lot can happen in 2 years to change a man. They could be just what they look like. King's men, hunting for military stores.
Well, sir, I do not think you'll find one of the King's men wearing this.
Because you have a medal from the Mother Church doesn't mean that you... The Liberty Tree. You're one of the Boston Band?
I am.
Could be stolen.
It could be.
But it isn't.
So, when I couldn't find my brother in Virginia, I came north, met Mr. O'Brien.
That still does not tell me why these two should come riding into here calling my daughter's name.
Well, Mr. O'Brien, Mr. Lumden here is a former soldier of the King's infantry, and I helped him to escape.
That doesn't explain Daisy.
Well, sir, see,
George. Well, the fact of the matter, sir, is, well, George and Daisy planned to marry.
What? You come riding in here bold as brass, wearing those red coats, and bringing me the news that this is going to be my son-in-law? I know times are mad, but they are not that mad.
Surely, sir, the story is much too impossible not to be true.
Well, I suppose so. If it's sanctuary you're seeking, the price is work.
Well, we will gladly pay that, sir. George plans no return to Boston, and, well, I would like to stay myself. That is, if I may.
Trouble with the crown?
There may be warrants for my arrest.
It, wouldn't have anything to do with that coat you borrowed and those stains on it, would it?
Yes, sir.
Well, then why didn't you say so, lad? That's the best recommendation you could have. You're in excellent company. Do you know they tell me that even men like Johnny Hancock and Sam Adams, their life is not worth a shilling if they linger too many more days in Boston? You know that?
Well, the fact is, we've been hearing that they might be headed this way. In your footsteps, as it were, sir.
A true son of liberty has mustered into the militia. Hasn't he?
Well, indeed I have, sir. The Boston Grenadiers under Captain Knox.
Well, then, since you're going to be staying, we must see that you get into Jim Barrett's company right away. Concord needs every man in its militia that it can get. Besides, we can use these coats for target practice. Huh? Eat. Go on. Eat, boys.
All militia companies are hereby put on notice. The Provincial Congress has resolved that any troop movement from Boston by the British to the number of 500 men shall be considered grounds for mobilization to a war-ready state. Now, there can be little doubt that we are but weeks away from war. Our alarm system using mounted couriers and church bells has been established. I consider you men ready to march at a moment's notice. Now, any of you not ready in heart and mind to accept open confrontation with His Majesty's Grenadiers, had best tell me now. Good. And let us assemble.
Philip! Philip! Great news! Daisy's arrived from Boston.
Big lummox, what a van.
She's here too. At Wright's Tavern in Concord, they've taken rooms, her and her father. Everyone's fled Boston. Everyone.
Things have been difficult. We were lucky to get out of Boston at all. This is all we were allowed to bring with us. As for the rest, the house and the furnishings, well, the soldiers of the Tories have no doubt looted the place already. But if Papa hadn't run, he would have faced arrest for his activities. Only Dr. Warren insisted on remaining behind, and Paul Revere to coordinate spying on the troops.
What about Mr. Eads?
The last I heard, he was starting to dismantle his press. He hopes to smuggle the pieces and what he needs to Watertown. He and the others are concerned about money.
I do not understand, Anne. Why money?
The printing of it. Or didn't that occur to you?
What is the matter with you?
This came for you. I kept it with your things. A private courier brought it to the door only hours before we left. I shouldn't have opened it, but under the circumstances. It's from his wife.
Alicia?
She wants you to come to her in Philadelphia. She says it's urgent.
Anne, I have no interest in anything she might have to say, urgent or otherwise. I have no reason to see her.
How do you know?
Because anything between us is dead now.
If you lay with her, Philip, if you shared her bed, how do you know there isn't something very much alive between the two of you?
A child?
Your father had a bastard, why not you?
Does she say that?
No, but you don't deny it's possible. You don't deny you took her the way he said you did. Why, Philip? Because you had to have everything that belonged to him? Because you had to prove you were his equal?
Anne, please.
It's always been with you, hasn't it? That need is what kept you from ever finding me good enough to share a life with. You still want all those dreams your mother spun for you. You want to be a nobleman. To have what they have, possess what they possess.
Anne, stop it.
It's true. Admit it. You want everything your brother had. Even his wife. You are going.
And I've gone through most of my life not knowing who I am. Not who I really am, or where I fit into this world. But if I fathered a child will never know the doubts that I've known.
What if I told you?
What?
Nothing. Safe journey?
You understand?
Yes.
I'll be back.
I suppose that's really one more thing you can't know about yourself now, Philip. But if you find out it's what you want, I'll be here. No.
Kent, view of the park, wood for the fire, bedroom adjacent, and a private bath.
Well, there must be some mistake, sir. I need only one room, a small one.
Oh, quite the contrary to Lady Amberley's instructions, sir. She said the finest. These are our finest.
How much?
Well, that's been taken care of, Mr. Kent, for the length of your stay.
I do not expect to be staying very long, sir.
To the contrary again, sir, but then, as I said, the lady is taking care of everything. Is there any further assistance I can provide?
No. Thank you. The room is quite adequate. Thank you very much.
As you say, sir.
Oh, one thing.
sir.
Did Lady Amberley say where she could be reached?
I believe she intends to contact you, sir, at her earliest convenience.
I see. Well, thank you, then.
Your servant, sir.
The letter said it was urgent.
Yes. I had to know you were all right. I had to see you. But you're really here. And there's nothing to ever keep us apart again.
Now that Roger is dead, you mean?
You know?
Well, apparently, there is something you do not know. I killed him.
You? Of course. I might have guessed.
So why did you send for me?
I've lived through hell, Philippe. It was unbearable with him. And I looked elsewhere, as I told you I'd have to. But every man I turned to, every man I tried to love, failed me. They were never you, Philippe. Don't ever let me go again.
It was you who let me go.
Where are those French ways? You haven't even told me you've missed me a little.
There is something I must ask you. Have there been children?
Children? No. Why? Is that it? You thought I'd borne you a child? No, Philippe. You've fathered no children yet. At least not that I know of. But then, of course, you must have had other relationships since we were last together. Is there anyone in particular?
Yes, there is.
Oh? In Boston?
She is waiting for me now.
Well, when it comes to waiting, Master Frenchman, I'm at the head of the line. And I demand my turn to sway your persuasions. Now.
Alicia.
Tell me you've forgotten how it was. Tell me. Tell me.
No, Alicia. No, I have not forgotten.
The nights you've dreamed why you were born, Philippe. You should have known you were born to share my bed.
Alicia.
All the dreams you've ever had, all the things you've ever wanted, they're not dreams anymore, Philippe. They're real. As real as I am.
Just you. You're very beautiful.
And you are in the hands of Bacchus.
No, Alicia. I'm in your hands. Beautiful hands. Lovely, lovely hands.
Loving hands.
Thank you.
one in that also.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Alicia, please.
You don't like it?
Well, it is not that I do not like it. It is just that I could never possibly wear them all.
Twice.
What?
You may never wear them all twice. But then a man in your position doesn't have to, darling. And one in the deep green as well.
Oh, most assuredly, Lady Amberley.
Stunning. Here.
No.
Just a look.
Alicia, no.
Please. You're absolutely right, Philippe. You're much more appealing in your natural state. That will be all, Martin.
Yes, ma'am.
Go ahead inside. I'll be along shortly.
Oh, you have something more important to attend to?
Well, I thought I might like to see how the rest of the world was doing.
Boston.
And England. And France. And even this fair town of Philadelphia, for all we've seen of it before today.
Don't be long.
Pardon, sir. Have you a copy of the Boston Gazette?
There's only one, and it's over 6 weeks old. I believe we are acquainted, are we not?
Well, Dr. Franklin, warmest greetings to you, sir.
Well, you're looking splendid, Master Charbonneau. Quite splendid indeed.
Thank you very much, sir.
Can the printing trade be doing so well by you in such a short time?
Well, I have had a bit of good fortune of late.
It would appear, Monsieur Charbonneau, it would appear. If you tell me that my letter of introduction admitted you to so fine a position as your tailor would indicate, I may be of a mind to go home and write one for myself.
Well, your letter was very much appreciated, sir, as I trust you know. Oh, by the way, I've taken a name, an American name here. Philip Kent.
Kent, huh? Philip Kent. Yes, has a good Yankee ring to it. Am I to presume, then, that you've decided to take up residence here in Philadelphia?
No, sir, in Boston. Well, that is until recently. As you know, the situation there has been rather uncertain. And the man I was working for, he's now relocating. A Mr. Eads, of Eads and Gill.
My, Ben Eads at that. Then you are just the young man I want to see. I've been thumbing through the pages of this Gazette, but as I said before, it's 6 weeks old. How long since you left?
Less than 3 weeks, sir.
Oh, then will you walk a while with me? I've had no news from Boston but rumors of late, and I want to see how things stand.
I would be most honored, sir.
Good. Come, let us walk, eh?
So the flames burn hotter.
Well, Mr. Adams says it would lead to war. He even seems to want it.
The others?
But the city stands divided, sir. Even some of the Sons of Liberty question the wisdom of total independence.
And you?
Well, my opinion is hardly important, sir.
Contrary. If war comes, it'll be young men like yourself who'll have to shoulder the muskets on both sides. Where will you stand then, huh?
I do not know, sir.
Mugwump.
I beg your pardon, sir.
Mugwump. The Algonquin Indians call their leaders Mukquams. But we have altered the word a bit in contemporary politics and made it Mugwumps. But it is not a leader to us. It's a new breed of bird who sits on a fence with his mug on one side and his wump on the other. Unfortunately, however, this new breed may soon become extinct. A bird sitting on a fence is bound to catch a ball in the crossfire when the shooting starts.
Well, then where do you stand, Dr. Franklin?
Well, I'm not at all certain that war will succeed. At best, only a fraction of the population will support armed hostilities. No matter what their dedication, they will be only untrained farmers pitted against regiments which have distinguished themselves in battlefields the world over.
Well, then you stand opposed.
No, I am persuaded it's the only road we can travel.
Toward independence?
Yes, but this time America will be a little more than just a bastard child, thrust into the world alone and unprotected, exposed to countless risks that the more timid and the more secure would never experience. A kind of independence, Philip, that can be forged into an existence infinitely stronger and weaker in a normal course of life.
Yes, I think I can understand that, sir. I am a bastard myself.
I know. That is one of the reasons I counseled you to come to America. We are all bastards here, Philip. Of English blood, but denied our heritage by a crown who refuses to recognize us as her rightful sons. If only someone in German George's court would stand up to him. But they won't do it. Not North, not Dartmouth, not Kentland. Well, what's the matter, lad? You're white as ashes.
You said Kentland?
Yes, James Amberley, the Duke of Kentland. He's the Assistant Secretary for Overseas Affairs.
Yes, I know who he is, sir. But you say he's alive?
Well, I can't speak for today, but he certainly was when I sailed. We spoke outside the House of Lords.
But they told us he died, sir. They said he was dead.
Lady Amberley, her son Roger?
You know about them and about me.
Not too difficult a task. From our conversation in London and what Solomon Sholto told me about your leaving and your new name, Philip Kent.
Damn them.
Philip. Don't hate them all. Not your father. I have a bastard son myself, and I love him nonetheless for his illegitimacy.
Yes, but my mother died because of what they did.
I doubt that the Duke knew that. Aside from his blind loyalty to the king, he's a wise and humane man in all respects.
I am once again in your debt, Doctor. The choice we've been discussing, you've made mine a very easy one.
It can't be an easy one. Not for any of us. But it may be necessary to survive, to know who we are and what we are to become.
And how goes the world with which you were so concerned?
A bit troubled.
It needn't trouble us.
You're very beautiful, Alicia.
Flattery, my lord, leads to who knows what.
You're truly an incredible woman.
I warn you, sir. A tongue like that makes a woman all too vulnerable. Philippe.
Philip.
Yes, Philip. My Philip.
Was it as easy the first time, Alicia?
What?
The wreaths at the door of Kentland, the shocked looks of the servants, the pretended show of grief. Was it as easy to buy all of that as it's been to buy me?
Philippe.
Philip. All of this, Alicia. These rooms, the clothes, the satin quilts, the wine, the smell of your perfume. All this time with a woman so warm and willing that could not possibly think of anything or anyone but her. This is a world I've never known, Alicia. A very, very powerful world. Wealth and title. They can buy anything, can they not? Or at least blind those of us who have never had them to the truth.
You spoke of Kentland. Of the Duke's death.
Yes, I did.
Then you found out.
Yes, Alicia. I finally found out.
Oh, I'm so glad. I didn't know how to ever tell you what happened, how it happened. And you don't hate me.
Hate you. All of the pieces of my life have finally fallen into place. Now, how could I possibly hate you for helping that to happen?
Oh, my darling, I was so frightened, so afraid you wouldn't understand.
Understand? Alicia. Of course I understand.
Then we can go to London tomorrow, together with the letter.
The letter?
From your father. The proof that his estate is rightfully yours.
My father would never honor that letter now, Alicia. Not when he learns how Roger died.
He doesn't have to know that.
You mean he is as easily deceived as I have been? Well, perhaps that is more proof in our relation than the letter would have been anyway.
You don't have it.
We still have each other, Alicia.
You've destroyed it?
It nearly destroyed me.
Philippe, tell me the truth.
The truth. The truth, my dear, beautiful Alicia, is that I am a fool. And you are a whore.
Philippe! Philippe!
Philip.
Listen to me. British troops are on the road to Concord. Flanker companies from different regiments. All those already armed remain here. The rest of you get your muskets and reassemble here as quickly as possible. We still have supplies to be moved. We need every hand we can get. Now set to. Kent.
Sir.
You'll be going out to fetch your musket?
Aye, sir.
Good. I need someone to stop at every farm along the North Road. Make sure all have heard the bells. Speed them on the way. I can count on you?
You can, sir.
Colonel Barrett.
I thought that was you. So you're back from Philadelphia?
Yes, sir. Is Anne inside?
What you did, what you must have said before you left, brought her as much grief as I've ever seen. She refused to give me any details except to tell me there was nothing more between you two, so you go on, carry out your orders, and don't ever try to see her again.
Mr. Ware...
I said leave her be! She wanted to protect you. But I remember her mother this way. That white look on her face, the spells of weakness in the morning.
Anne is with child? Sir, I have to see her.
I'll use it, Kent. If you even try to see her again.
Kent! Damn it, get going. Now that's an order.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Well, breathlessly.
Kent.
Mr. Revere.
Do you know him?
Aye. From Boston. And a high son of liberty, too. You came up the post road?
Aye, sir, I did.
Any sign of redcoats?
Well, no, sir, none.
There's a detachment abroad. We've no wish to run afoul of them. Aye, lad. We're riding express to give the alarm. Last night, light infantry and grenadiers started slipping aboard boats on the back bay. We might have been surprised, too, but one of our lads found two mongrels bayoneted on the streets.
To prevent them from barking. But thanks to Mr. Revere and Mr. Dawes, our expedition is a secret no longer.
If you're still with the militia, you'd best get to your unit. British. Away, and Godspeed.
Good day, gentlemen. May we crave your names?
Paul Revere from Boston.
Revere. Gentlemen, we have made a fortunate catch. And who are your friends, sir?
They may speak or not as they choose.
They bloody well better speak or we'll blow their damned heads off.
Dr. Prescott of Concord.
Dawes of Boston.
Kent, Boston.
Kent. There's a warrant out on this one. Aiding a deserter and suspicion of murder.
Follow us across the draw, sir. And Mr. Revere, we have heard of your excellent horsemanship. So you'll take your hands off your reins and let your horse walk.
Fight against the crown, and we're leaving a Tommy to care for the farm.
Well, I'd feel much better if we had a spare musket or two, sir.
Now, don't you worry, Sergeant. If the grenadiers get this far, there are plenty of sickles and scythes in the barn, and a loft you can use to drop down on them by surprise.
By God, you can count on it.
What about me?
You'll be riding with us to Concord. If there's to be marauding, it's best you're in company. Lucas, let's saddle the horses.
I tried to see Anne in the village, but her father would not permit it. Tell me truthfully, Daisy. Is she with child?
Yes, sir. I'm sure it's true.
Will you give her a message for me?
I'll try, sir.
In case we do not return, tell her that she has my love.
Yes, sir. God bless you, sir.
Thank you, Daisy. Oh, and thank you for bringing my things.
Mm-hmm.
sir. What you do there?
I'm buying my freedom, Lucas.
Sir?
You met my mother on the road to Bristol.
Aye, she was sick.
She was tormented all of her life by a fear of poverty. She once told me that the greatest crime a man could commit is living in poverty, dying in obscurity. She made me vow to her that I would never do that. That vow sold me into slavery.
You are bound to no man.
No, not to a man, but to a way of life. My mother was wrong, Lucas. Living in bondage to another person's principles, another person's values. Bondage of the body, bondage of the soul, it doesn't matter which. That is the greatest crime a man can commit. For it is a crime against himself that destroys his own identity, even his own worth.
That's freedom, sir. Now, if you're ready to defend it, your horse is saddled. Mr. O'Brien is waiting. Anne, I thought you might want this. It's a little old, but it's warm.
Are you sure you will not need it?
Well, a man doesn't need more than one coat at a time, sir.
No. No, he doesn't.
Redcoats are at Concord. The commander's headquartered at Wright's Tavern. The soldiers are going from house to house.
Has there been fighting?
Not when I left. The troops are on one side of the bridge. An armed militia is forming a line to hold them there.
We'd better get to Colonel Barrett.
Daisy, you stay here with Mr. Ware.
Annie, I tried to see you.
My father told me.
Why did you ever let me go?
You had to go, Philip. But oh, how I prayed you'd come back.
Why didn't you tell me about the baby?
I almost did. But I couldn't use that to hold you.
Anne, I love you.
I love you.
Ken.
Yes, sir.
Annie, men will die today on both sides. God knows what the future will bring for any of us, or what I can promise you. But if I come back, and if you'll have me.
Yes, Philip. Yes.
Sir.
Philip Kent, one of a rare breed of men. Men who were free-spirited individuals who called themselves Americans and marched together to create a nation that would guarantee life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.